I believe a dark tidal wave is on the horizon. It's a wave of hostility and persecution that is about to crash onto the church. We have been conditioned not to expect persecution. It's because I know how dangerous, how difficult persecution can be, that I have such a sense of urgency for the United States. I'm focusing on preparation of the heart to be faithful till the end. Hello, everyone. In this session, I want to talk about one final danger area, deception, and some strategies God gives so that we can protect ourselves. Probably a large number of believers think this is not a danger area for them. But when Jesus warns about deception, he's talking specifically about the people of God, and especially so in a context of persecution. He says, "See to it that no one deceives you. They will deliver you over to be persecuted, and you will be hated by all nations because of my name. At that time, many will fall away and will betray and hate one another, and many false prophets will arise and mislead many." I've wondered, how could deception creep into the church? What could this look like in our country? I've mentioned two wedge issues that I think are going to drive persecution. One is the exclusivity of Jesus in salvation, that he's the only way to God. The second is that Jesus demands obedience from his followers in a number of areas that are flashpoints in our culture now, such as marriage, gender identity, sexual morality, life, biblical justice, and so on. Accepting these truths is part of being a faithful follower of Jesus. In opposition to this are some ungodly American values. As I mentioned last session, the messaging from our culture is that the pursuit of pleasure and self-actualization, self-fulfillment, is the highest value. Follow your heart. Be authentic. Be true to yourself. So in practice, this means that I do what makes me feel good. My feelings determine my own truth, and I live according to my truth. The problem is that the church has been marinating in these values to such a degree that many Christians have absorbed them. Many who identify as Christian deny the exclusivity of Jesus in salvation. They think there are many ways to God. And many do not think the demands of Jesus for obedience apply to them. They've lost their sensitivity to sin and justify all kinds of sinful behavior. So there's already a level of deception that has spread among believers. Many church leaders are even now hesitant to teach on these two wedge issues, because it will cause division and conflict within the church. In addition, there will be tremendous external pressure on pastors to compromise. And those who do compromise will be held up as examples of good and acceptable Christianity by society. Some leaders will compromise to avoid persecution. That is because of cowardice. But there's a more insidious compromise because it comes from good motives. The desire to protect their ministry. It goes like this: if I avoid certain issues, then I'll be able to continue my ministry, which is producing fruit and is serving people. So the motives may be good, but in the end, that church will lose its purity and witness. So we may end up with an approved church, the church that aligns with progressive values, that's pitted against the church of hate. The commanding heights of our culture will applaud the progressive church as loving and inclusive and tolerant, and condemn those who remain faithful to Jesus. This isn't a new tactic. Communist governments have often allowed and propped up an approved church that they can control and that would serve the interests of the state. And this corrupted church ends up persecuting true Christians. We know this from the firsthand experience of many of our Hungarian relatives who remained faithful during the communist years. I think many believers will be confused. They'll be confused by their leaders and confused by the loud messaging from our culture. Should they go to the inclusive, loving, approved church? Or to the church that so many say is unloving, bigoted, ignorant, hateful? This is how many could drift away, not so much because of direct apostasy, but through deception. And so I expect that we will see an exodus from the church that remains faithful. Some will leave in confusion, and some to save themselves from the rising cost of faithful discipleship. It's difficult to be misunderstood and hated. And some, in the rush to distinguish themselves from the people of hate, will actually turn against and hate the people they had considered their brothers and sisters. Jesus warned about this. He said, many will fall away and will betray and hate one another. Deceived believers will attack faithful believers. I think things are going to become very messy and confusing. So, how do we protect ourselves and our families from deception? I want to share with you a dream that a friend of mine had a couple of years ago, before the pressures that were unleashed through the pandemic. Brad is a theologically conservative Presbyterian pastor and seminary professor. In the dream, Brad and I were alone in a desert. There were miles of sand, and strangely, on the horizon, there was a huge tidal wave being held back by God's hand at the coast, dark, oily waters churning for release, only God staying its power. A voice said, "You must build a tower of sand to be protected and to guard my word, for soon the wave will be released." It seemed odd. Sandcastles seem unable to stand against such a wave. But we began piling up sand into a tower like kids on a beach, and it grew more and more solid around us. The dream ended with us waiting inside this hand-built tower for the wave, at peace. In the dream, Brad and I represent leaders of God's people. We are to prepare God's people. The wave is persecution and testing that are coming to the body of Christ. God has been holding back his refining and the enemy's anger. And as for grains of sand, in the Bible, they often represent the people of God. So God could be asking us to build a wall of people, their faith, their prayers, their relationships, so that we will stand against the enemy's wave. Perhaps it will be our network of love and connections for each other which will give us strength. In the dream, the feeling Brad had was not one of fear, but of choice and faith. Will you listen and obey? So building a tower wall of sand seems pointless against such a large tidal wave. No sand wall could ever hope to hold. But God is seeking obedience, not understanding. He's seeking trust, not perfect preparation. The Lord desires that we build the tower and then trust him to make it stand strong. He will bind it together so it cannot be washed away. It is his tower and it is his power which shall accomplish the protection. Now, whether or not you think that dream was from God, it underlines a couple of steps that will help us to stand under the pressure of persecution. First, we need to build community with other believers. Over the years, I had taught about the importance of strengthening relationships in the church and building community, but I came to really believe it in prison. I felt very isolated in prison as the only American with a different culture and life experience than my cellmates, but I was most isolated by my faith. I was the only Christian. All of my cellmates were very committed Muslims, and the only contact I had with another Christian was with Noreen when she was allowed to visit me. I was intensely lonely, even when in an overcrowded cell. I had no fellow believer to encourage me, no one to pray with me, and when I was overwhelmed with doubt and became confused, I had no one to challenge my wrong thoughts and correct me. I was especially vulnerable and weak because I was on my own. I gained a new appreciation for the church, for the fellowship I'd had with other believers. Even as I was learning how difficult it is to be alone in my faith, I could see the sharp contrast with my Muslim cellmates. When a new person was added to our cell, the others would quickly pull him into their Muslim prayers and chanting of the Quran. If he wasn't a zealous Muslim when he came into the cell, he became zealous within a few weeks. When I was transferred to a maximum security prison, I was held with one other prisoner, Ramazan, for about a month. Then a second prisoner was added to our cell. Almost immediately, Ramazan began to do his prayers with a lot more energy. He started to read the Quran more. He had a new drive in him. This was the difference between being alone and having even one fellow believer. I learned to survive without much contact with other Christians, but it made it much, much more difficult. I would think about which of my Christian friends I would want to have in prison with me for encouragement. I was desperate to know I was not forgotten, that people were praying for me, that even though I was alone in my cell, I was still connected to the body. When Peter writes about enduring persecution, he emphasizes, above all things, have fervent love for one another. Then he goes on to encourage offering hospitality to one another and serving one another. In other words, build community. So this is a biblical strategy. I think it's especially important now to build relationships that will strengthen us in times of pressure. I'm not talking about the wider unity of the church. This can be very abstract. I'm talking about intentionally growing love, prayer, faithfulness, and trust with a smaller circle of friends. In our individualistic society, it takes more effort to get close to people and to let them get close to us, but it is worth it. The New Testament especially talks of the church in family terms, spiritual fathers and mothers, sons and daughters. These family relationships are going to be so very important in the years ahead. Along with building community, the second step is to guard the word. And these two are connected. Having community is not enough. Our community needs to be built around the word. This is the foundation for our unity. And who you build community with is very important. I've seen many people drift away from God because they chose the wrong circle of friends, people who are not committed to the authority of the Bible. And the word needs guarding because many want to dilute it, misuse it, and downgrade its authority. We must be committed to God's truth as revealed in the Bible. God determines what is true, not man. There is no my truth. There is God's truth. Here is a principle. Say what God says. That is, I must choose to say about everything what God says about it. This means I must say about myself what God says about me. I must say about others what God says about them. I must say about God what He says about Himself. This also means that whatever God says is good, I must call good. And what God says is sin, I must call sin. If you do this, it will put you at odds with the mainstream of our culture. It will put you at odds with the progressive church. Even many evangelical church leaders are hesitant to speak truth, as I already mentioned. Here's an example of how this applies to the two wedge issues. The Bible says Jesus is the only way to salvation. Many will say this is offensive, that it's not inclusive. But I must say about Jesus what He says about Himself. The Bible identifies certain behaviors as sin, and Jesus demands we avoid these sins. Many are going to say this is narrow-minded, it's bigoted, it's hateful. But I must say about sin what God says about it. The Bible says God is going to judge people and punish sin. Many will say this is a message of hate that twists God's character because He's a God of love who doesn't judge. But I must say what God says about Himself. I don't have to understand. I don't have to defend God. What I have to do is come into agreement with Him. God has a side, and we need to make sure we're lining up with His side. And this takes determination and courage. I'm not encouraging people to become culture warriors. For much of my life, I've lived as a member of a spiritual minority, under some pressure. In Turkey, we were a small group of Christians in a sea of Islam. I didn't push our church members to go out to challenge the sins in their culture and to confront sinners. Instead, we focused on preparing them to be obedient disciples of Jesus, to remain faithful, to love God and others, and to share their faith. I'm not so much concerned about sin among unbelievers as I am that the church be faithful. However, anyone who desires to lead a godly life will face some persecution. And those who are hostile to God's truth are often not content to leave us alone, even when we're not challenging them directly. I think in the U.S., they will demand that we approve and celebrate behavior and views that God calls sin. And they'll punish those who don't. In the film series Lord of the Rings, a ragtag group of various races band together to resist an evil horde. And they're vastly outnumbered, but they fight. Not because they think they'll win, but because it's right. And so, God gives us a strategy that we gather our own ragtag groups, that we build our small communities. And we are to stand for truth because this is right. I don't know what will happen to our country in the long run, but we do know that Jesus, whose name is faithful and true, wins in the end. In summary, deception can so easily derail us. It's important to determine that you will say about God and yourself and the world what God says about it. Pledge allegiance to Jesus and stand without apology or shame. In our final session, I'm going to talk about some of the unexpected blessings that come from enduring persecution. I don't suggest that anyone ask for persecution in order to grow spiritually, but I did gain some very precious things from my time in prison. I think this will be encouraging for you.